जो देश है तेरा, स्वदेश है तेरा, तुझे है
Hello and a warm welcome to this special program, 70 Years of Freedom. I'm Neelu Vyas. As the country enters into the seventh decade of its birth and survival, there have been many giant leaps which have been taken in terms of development and other social indicators. But there are many challenges which still remain. What's the journey ahead and what has been the journey so far in the last 70 years and also dissecting it in the present context? Joining me now is a scintillating panel of guests. Next to me is Mridula Mukherjee, the eminent historian and author. Next to him is a man who doesn't need any introduction, Manishankar Iyer, veteran Congress leader, author, a former diplomat. And next to him is P. Muralidhar Rao. He's again the general secretary of BJP, a man who's also of an RSS background. Welcome all of you on this special program. And not to forget, yes, you must have heard the claps already. Apart from the guests, we have a scintillating and a bright set of students from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, Amity University, APJ University and Manav Rachna International University. So all of them are here and they are going to have an interactive session with this bright set of panel which is here, and they will be free to ask questions. The panelists will pose them questions. My first question to you, Mr. Manishankar Iyer, I would like to start from you, is that if freedom is really responsibility, how far have you really gone ahead? Without getting into any kind of political rhetoric, I would just like to know an individual viewpoint, that how responsible really have we been in terms of freedom?
Considerably.
Okay.
Yes, there are gaps, but I think we should begin on a positive note.
Okay.
Because after all, at the time we became independent, it was widely predicted that there would be the Balkanization of India and that we would collapse. Churchill said that the country was being handed over to men of straw. And given the trauma of partition, it did seem uncertain as to whether we would be able to survive, to use the word you used in your introduction.
Right.
We've not only survived, we flourished. And I think if we understand the basic reasons for this, without going into the politics of it, we would have to begin by understanding the concept of our nation being based on unity in diversity.
Right.
And diversity includes diversity of opinion.
Okay.
And until 1947, the Congress was a movement. And within that movement, it held a diversity of opinion. In 1947, it started converting itself into a political party.
Okay.
And when it did, it opened the doors for other political parties to express their opinion. But by then we had a parliament, well, to begin with a constituent assembly and later a parliament, within which these contending schools of thought could intellectually combat each other and determine the destiny of the nation.
I'm going to take a cue from what Mr. Iyer said, that freedom so far has been about the celebration of unity and diversity, as he said. Mr. Muralidhar Rao, you have to answer a lot on behalf of the government as well as RSS. In terms of unity and diversity, do you really think that the nation has been responsible?
In my view, in the last seven decades, there has been a consensus.
Okay.
Cutting across.
But when you say consensus, it's consensus on what all grounds? What is the benchmark you really look at?
I mean, coming to the point, there has been a consensus. Consensus is the unity of the country.
Okay.
Whenever the unity of the country has been challenged by outside force or sometimes by inside forces, there has been a political consensus and there has been always a national consensus about the unity of the country. And also, unity with diversity, what it has been said now, a country linguistically diverse, religiously diverse, and socially it's a diverse society. So all diversities we have now, added to that the political diversity we have. So even after all this diversity, diversity is cherished, diversity is nurtured and accepted. So with all these things, we have been able to prove that as a diverse country, we can preserve and maintain the unity, and we can also nurture the diversity. And the neighboring countries have not been able to do.
In fact, President Obama has also quoted on the diversity and unity of a country like India. Mrituluji, I would like to bring in you here that when we are talking about the unity and diversity, according to your opinion, has it just been in the form of narratives? Has it just been in the form of a political rhetoric? Has it just been there for the sake of being there? How would you see, how would you look at the last 70 years?
No, I think that, as Manishankar Iyerji said, that there have been considerable achievements, okay, which doesn't mean that there haven't been failures.
Right.
And I'd like to again reiterate that fact that despite the trauma of partition, which affected millions in this country, we were able to establish a secular constitution. We were able to hold general elections based on adult franchise within a matter of 3 years. And then we were able to internalize in the minds of people the values of democracy, diversity, pluralism, secularism, I think in a very substantial way.
Right.
I would say this story carries on till about the 70s and the 80s.
Okay.
And there was a consensus, but I think fissures in this consensus begin to appear from about the 80s, and I think the Babri Masjid incident was a big break in this consensus.
So you because would call for it the as first one
time, because for the first time in a substantial way, mm-hmm, after independence, there was popular mobilization, not just one incident in happening somewhere on a local issue, a riot happening, and then everybody saying this is wrong and trying to solve the matter, but a mobilization, a consistent, planned mobilization to actually bring about polarization in Indian society,
right,
which violated the consensus on the unity in diversity. But so I think fissures began to appear, and I'm sorry
and
to say that the story,
right,
since then has not been the story of achievement which we saw,
okay,
almost linear,
but, right,
but a different story which we need to take on board.
But Mr. Iyer, the fissures at which Mriduluji is pointing out, what do you think has been the basic reason of these fissures? Of course, Babri Masjid has been one incident which highly mobilized the people, it divided the society on communal lines. But apart from that, there have been governments who have ruled the country. Why were they not able to control? Was it that the ruling government couldn't have a consensus with the opposition? Or was it the opposition which was trying in a bid to come back to power, didn't try and contain incidents like this? What was the real reason?
There are two basic philosophies informing the concept of our nationhood.
Okay.
It was Jawaharlal Nehru who used the expression, the idea of India.
Okay.
And so in a sense, the Nehruvian camp has appropriated that phrase and said that the idea of India is more fundamentally based on secularism than on any other single concept.
Okay.
But that you cannot have a secular country without a democratic country, and without a country that looks after those who are oppressed and which maintains the independence of the nation. There was an alternative narrative that goes back to the early 20s when Vinay Damodkar Savarkar brought out an alternative philosophy which he called Hindutva, in which he basically argued that only those who regard this land as their Pitribhumi, their fatherland, and as their Punyabhumi, the land from which their faith derives, can be proper Indians, and by definition they had to be Hindus.
Right.
And he propagated an alternative vision of our nationhood. I think Muralidhar Rao is right in saying that where there was a sharp divide between the Savarkar view of India and the Gandhi-Nehru view of India, the fact that we brought in a constitution, ran a democracy, didn't try to balance it. It gave the opportunity for those who espoused the alternative idea of India to enter our political system.
Right.
They've had a rough ride because for the first 40 years they were really irrelevant to the political process. But since the 1990s, they have increasingly come into the space. And it's resulted in a divide even within the Hindutva movement, where there are the politicians who feel they must adjust to the ground reality as well as the constitutional compulsions, and therefore become rather more secular than was expressed in the Hindutva philosophy. And there are others who say that notwithstanding the adaptation that has taken place, the battle is still on for the soul of India, because if you emphasize the majoritarianism of Hinduism in a country which is 85%, the others will feel that they are being marginalized. So the battle continues, but thank God it has been brought within the framework of the democratic institutions which were set up at the start of our independence.
But Mr. Muralidhar Rao, this Savarkar view of the nation and the Nehruvian view of the nation, what Mr. Iyer is talking about, he spoke of a certain Hindu Rashtra at that time. Certain years, in fact, certain decades have passed, and still we are talking about a concept like Hindu Rashtra. My question to you is, that has the nation really matured? Because when a human being is maturing, and a 70-year-old man is said to be a mature man, but we as a nation are still saying that we are not a mature democracy, we are not a mature nation. What do you think is the basic reason for this?
No, I don't agree that India has not matured, or like a 70-year-old man. India is a country of the young people. At the same time, India has also demonstrated...
No offense meant to the people in the 70s.
India has also many times demonstrated its maturity compared to any other even Western countries where democracy is practiced. When democracy itself was threatened, the people of this country and the political spectrum cutting across all ideologies, they have valued democracy as an inalienable thing and which we have to keep it. So for that people have fought, and now everybody accepts democracy is a very important thing and it has become successful. So okay. First point. Second important thing would like to say is Hindutva, whatever, you know, people have different perspectives and different interpretations. How you interpret
the biggest interpretation which comes is that probably divides
the society. I agree the interpretation given or accepted by the Supreme Court as a way of life, and the secularism which we talk about, the secularism, I don't see that it has come from only Nehru. Even Nehru has absorbed the essence of this soil, and he, that is the reason he has articulated the secularism in such a way. So in this country, secularism is successful, not because of some imitation of the Western
why
country.
Why do we see that the word secularism is suddenly becoming a flashpoint between political parties like Congress and BJP? What is the reason? I'll ask Mr. Iyer also, but first you answer.
No, but here...
what is the main reason for that?
Day-to-day politics and the political mobilization. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it is interpreted in such a way to suit the interests of this following and that following. But I would like to say here, when you have a democracy, when you have a political, ideas clashing, and the identity issues are also emerging. Sometimes the identity issue around which some mobilization has taken place, it is treated as a threat to secularism, but I don't think it has never been, and it will be
Mr. Iyer, why do you think that this word secularism is suddenly becoming a flashpoint?
Because the other side usually pronounces it as secularism.
Okay.
Is it a sickness or is it the heart and soul of our country? I didn't for a moment suggest...
Secularism, you're spelling it as S-I-C-K, right?
That's the way in which it sometimes gets pronounced. Why is this word there? It's not because we're imitating anybody. It's because there is no easy, ready equivalent. We thought in the Constitution that we could use the word dharmanirpekshta.
Right.
But Muralidhar's lot objected. And they said, ki dharm ke prati aap kaise nirpeksh ho sakte ho? So they've invented a word called panth nirpekshta. So obviously, the expression in contemporary India, independent India, has its own particular connotation.
So basically, both the and parties, Mridulaji.
No, one second. This is very important.
Right. Okay, go ahead.
I request you to not interrupt here. To understand, it's not Nehru, it's not even Gandhi, it is India. Over 5,000 years, we have demonstrated an ability to live with heterogeneity that no one else in the world has done. And it is therefore a reflection of India's civilizational greatness to attribute this to all the different diversities that have flown into our country from every major religion of the world, including those that were born here, and not to attribute it only to the Sanatana Dharma. And that makes for a big divide. I call it a rift valley. Okay. And until that rift valley is bridged, the challenge between the two ideas of India will continue.
These are two different ideologies which are being spoken about. Mr. Iyer is talking about a particular ideology. Mr. Muralidhar Rao is talking about a particular ideology. Why do you think that these ideologies, it is very difficult for the political class to accommodate these two kind of ideologies? There is a certain intolerance which has been spoken of at large in the past few months, especially in the last 2 years, the political intolerance, the ideological intolerance. What do you think is the basic reason? Why is the political class getting so unaccommodative?
No, I think there are two different issues.
Okay.
It's one thing to say you accommodate an opposite point of view, which means you compromise with it.
Okay.
You take something from it and put, make it part of your own. That is not necessary.
Mm-hmm.
I have every right to hold to my very firm, strict, pure view, if I like, of secularism or whatever, just as Mr. Muralidhar Rao has.
Okay.
We can argue, we can debate, and we can hope we can influence each other.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, if we can't, I think what's most important, and this is what our constitution guarantees to us, and our tradition guarantees to us, and our freedom struggle has guaranteed to us, is the freedom to continue to believe and have the freedom to continue to express what you believe. And that's, no, excuse
me,
I want to finish this. This is where the crux is coming today. The Congress party and other similar parties which held power more or less for the first 50 years after independence, did believe in totally in freedom of expression and freedom of civil liberties, freedom of press, freedom of association and all that. The BJP says it believes in them.
But it doesn't
fact practice. Of the matter is that the assaults that we are seeing today on freedom of expression, I come from a university which has been badgered in the last 6 months for some students expressing some points of view which have been arbitrarily declared without proper investigation or this thing to be anti-national, and then you are picked up and you are made into scapegoats and you are called anti-national.
In fact, I'll come to
I want to just elaborate upon this further. And this is not just a question of JNU. This is happening everywhere, whether it's the Dalit issue, whether it's the issue of the Muslims, whether it's the issue of cow slaughter and all that. I think what is happening is the freedom to some groups of people with the aid and backing of state power to impose their version of how people should live their lives on others and get away with it.
But
this is actually assaults on our freedom, which has been guaranteed to us by our constitution.
Mr. Rao, the way we have seen the things, I'm talking about the Dalit issue, the Dalit atrocities which have been on the rise, then there has been a certain scaremongering which has been, the intelligentsia, the liberal intelligentsia feels threatened, that probably there is no space for dissent, there is a certain intolerance. And
the minister in the PMO used the word the other day, intellectual terrorism. What does it mean?
Okay.
Somebody who talks a different point of view is now called a terrorist.
Okay.
Only you are saying intellectual terrorist.
Why is this?
Tomorrow Manishankara and both will be called intellectual terrorists.
But Mr. Muralidhar
Rao, behind bars for being a different kind of
why
terrorist.
Why do you think that there has been a certain silence on the part of the government? We hear statements coming up here and there, but they are very erratic. Sometimes the Prime Minister will make a statement. Sometimes, you know, we'll hear from some quarter of the BJP. But there is not a consensus. Sensual condemnation of a particular incident, for example, maybe the Dalit atrocities which we have seen in Una.
You know, in this, first of all, I don't agree. I would like to say that it's intellectual terrorism or these kind of things. You know, for the last so many years, a certain kind of people who have been working from different institutions and with different positions and with different perspectives, you know, now there is a challenge to the kind of thinking which they used to express. If freedom of expression was never curtailed in the past, if that was so, then what happened in 1975? What do you call an emergency? So
let's hear Mr. Iyer on this. Obviously.
I condemn the emergence.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So do I.
I think it was an aberration.
Yeah.
I do not think that was the right solution to the problem at that stage.
Okay.
And I want to give the credit to the person who imposed this emergency.
Okay.
Without any outside pressure on her, either from within the country or outside, she decided to withdraw this emergency. So she made a mistake, she recognized it, acknowledged it, and ended it.
But my question to you is that if Congress committed the mistake and it tried to improve on it, why not BJP?
No, here BJP...
But first tell me, does BJP really admit to the fact that this cow politics, Dalit atrocities, are these really mistakes on the part of the government?
When Prime Minister had already spoken on that, the kind of initiatives or whatever the steps from different groups in the name of cow protection, it should not go to that extent, and taking the law into hands is not, exposing the cause of the cow. It is within the purview of the freedom of expression, I would like to say. So, taking the law into hands.
Prime Minister addressed a law and order issue that you really have to rein in the gau rakshas.
And in the Dalit issue. We have to accept cutting across the political differences and classes. We have to accept the problem of Dalit. It is there in the society.
But Mr.
And
Rao,
as a society, we have to solve. This is a social evil. And all political parties, irrespective of the other differences, we have been working. And BJP also does not accept the kind of discrimination which is there among the...
I totally agree with what you're saying. An outright condemnation, of course, is the first thing. But even after Prime Minister has condemned this incident, there have been organizations like VHP, there have been organizations like the Hindu Mahasabha who have come out and given statements that, we'll go to all extents to see that, this kind of a thing doesn't happen. In fact, the Gau Raksha Dal chief, Mr. Kaushik himself spoke about this.
Saying that I have a background of RSS. Even RSS has issued a statement, elaborated statement. So, cow protection is different, propagating the cause of the cow is different, even the people in Congress will propagate the cause of the cow. It doesn't mean that it's a monopoly of BJP or monopoly of some party. So, the issue or the advocacy of the cow protection is part of the constitution. Take it into that zone.
In one line,
any organization, if it says that law and order and issue is the issue which the organizations can take and can handle, definitely we cannot accept as a nation.
But Mridulaji,
so there should not be any difference.
Outright condemnation coming from the BJP, from the Prime Minister, and the RSS organization saying something else. Do you really find it convincing? Do you really find it credible at the face of it, at least?
I do hope that it is convincing and credible and genuine. Okay. Why should I doubt my Prime Minister, and why should I doubt respectable members of public society like Mr. Muralidhar Rao? I do give them the credit, or the benefit of believing that they say what they mean, as I hope they give to me. I think what's important, however, is not just what we are saying, at a particular point in time. Number one, it often comes too late. Number two, it's of what's happening on the ground. There was an expose done in a major channel 3 or 4 days ago, right, where they showed in one part of the country in graphic detail how, in the name of cow protection, people are extorting lakhs and lakhs of rupees.
How would you
justify so-called cow rakshas? Why is the state machinery? There is clearly a message that's been sent down the line. It doesn't have to be, Let's the RSS or any other organization is not going to pass a resolution saying, please go and beat up people who are doing this.
We are discussing the major challenges
but
as
it's
a nation
message
we are facing on the occasion of 70 years of freedom. Dalit issue is the issue on which every political party, even the spirit of the freedom movement, we have to accept, and on that there should not be any difference of opinion.
Why
there should not be any disagreement.
Why not the same thing on the issue of a clerk and the cow slaughter allegation over there? Why only on Dalit issue it should be a national consensus? Why on the Muslim issue we should be divided?
As a country, when after 70 years we have been able to preserve both diversity and also the unity, what does it mean? And diversity, when I said, is a religious diversity as also important thing. So, who can go against the religious diversity?
Okay,
so there should not be a kind of
so the difference of opinion is still there. Difference of opinion is still there, but our larger debate on Dalit atrocities, we cannot restrict this entire debate only to Dalit atrocities and secularism, because we have to talk about other burning issues like Kashmir, foreign policy, the way it has been dealt over the last 70 years. But we'll take a break, and when we come back, we go to these larger questions and also interact with this audience, which is going to take questions from the panelists, and it's going to be two-way. Back in a moment. Welcome back. You're watching our special program, 70 Years of Freedom. Before we went into the break, we questioned the panelists about the larger questions on secularism, Dalit atrocities, but there are many issues which still remain unresolved. And one of them is Kashmir. Kashmir is still boiling. And what are the reasons? Since 1947, we see that Kashmir remains as a headline on all the TV news channels, which we see even today. My first question to you, Mr. Iyer, is because Congress has ruled the country for more than five decades almost, and BJP has in a way just begun to rule for the last 2 years almost, and a brief stint of 5 years earlier.
Six years.
What is the main reason for the Kashmir dispute to remain unresolved yet?
Of these five decades, I would draw your attention to the first four.
Right.
It was not until 1990 that Kashmir exploded. Until then, there were problems, but there was an attempt made, more or less successful, less successful in many respects, but more or less successful, to keep the lid on the issues. And the kind of demonstrations that we've seen since the 1990s did not have an existence from 1947 till about 1990. In 1989, December, within a few days of the formation of the V.P. Singh government, Mufti Saab's daughter was kidnapped. And because of a lack of experience of handling these kind of crises, while Rajiv Gandhi had approached a Kashmiri judge of the Allahabad High Court to set up a back channel to talk to these people and say it's completely un-Islamic to kidnap a young unmarried woman and please restore her, the government decided to release a number of terrorists.
Right.
Among the terrorists released is the head of today's Jaish-e-Mohammed. So at that time, the mistake that was made was then compounded.
But even during the UPA rule, we saw the issue boiling
tremendous.
Up.
I gave the
stone
credit.
Pelters going
amok. I gave the credit to Mr. Vajpayee, but carrying it forward and all the way through till about 2008-2009 has to go to Dr. Manmohan Singh on the one hand,
right,
and Pervez Musharraf on the other. There was a lot of progress made. Unfortunately, I regret this as a congressman, the outcome of the roundtable conferences, the outcome of the all-party delegation, the outcome of the interlocutors remained more or less locked up in the cupboard.
But Mr. Rao, my question to you is that are we really addressing the right people? Why are we only looking at a militaristic approach? Why not a political dialogue with all the stakeholders? And first of all, you identify, your government identifies who are the real stakeholders. Separatists have their own voice. BJP has a different voice. Then the indigenous militants, they are having their own voices. For the first time, I was reading an article on human rights, which said that for the first time, the ratio of the indigenous militants and the foreign militants, it has grown. The indigenous militants are far by greater in number. What is the real reason for this?
Kashmir issue is a very important for us in the context of our nationhood. And on this, there is a consensus. On this, there is a consensus among consensus.
But there is a larger feeling that there is a difference in the way the government is looking at it. Government looks at the land of Kashmir and the Kashmiris differently.
No. You know, land and people can never be separated from anywhere, not only in Kashmir or anywhere. So that simplistic interpretation is not going to resolve the issue. Kashmir on Kashmir issue, all political parties. In the context of nationhood, we have always taken a view that Kashmir is an integral part of the country.
Okay.
as far as that is concerned, and all opposition parties, when even BJP was in opposition, we had cooperated with the then ruling party, Congress, and our leaders also represented the Indian view on the international fora. So, on this issue, we have to agree that when we define the nationhood, there is a consensus. Second, we have to accept there is a Pakistan. And Pakistan is based on the two nation theory and particularly based on the religion. And they have a permanent interest in creating the problem and in sustaining the problem in Kashmir.
Why do the people in Kashmir now are saying, especially after the Burhan Wani's killing, why are the people saying that Kashmir has never gone through times like these ever before?
You know, I don't agree with that. When you say Kashmir, I want to know what is this Kashmir? Okay. Kashmir is only Muslims? And what about the Kashmiri Pandits? Without excluding Kashmiri Pandits, can you call there is any Kashmiriyat? When you call Kashmiriyat, Kashmiri Pandits are also part and parcel of that Kashmir identity.
Mritula ji, the way the Kashmir problem is dealt by the political class, irrespective of the blame game between Congress and the BJP, what do you think is the real solution? Are we really addressing the right people for resolving this problem? Are we really serious? Is the political class really serious?
I have a feeling that perhaps Mr. Rao is underestimating the gravity of the situation today.
Right.
Because he is thinking that it's just another episode. The sense that we are getting from reading what's going on and from talking to people who are experts in the field, from people who've been there, etc., is that it's very different. There is a degree of alienation, and particularly among the youth, which goes far beyond anything that's getting expressed in terms of what we are seeing in the newspapers.
Now, how do you address problems like, when Mr. Rajnath Singh tweets and addresses to the people, but the internet is blocked? Now, how would you really explain situations like this?
Also, you have to be aware that
step in times of crisis, in times of emergency, we should not take it as a permanent state of affairs that was only aimed at controlling the situation.
When curfew goes on for more than a month, it sort of feels like very permanent to the people who are suffering.
Right.
Where all the disruptions of the social media again go on for a fairly long period. And I want to emphasize this. You are now, the people who are on the streets are young people mostly, and they are people who have been born in conflict.
Okay.
They are people who do not remember the peaceful days of the 60s and the 70s and the 80s. So I think this is very important. We have to understand the psychology of people with whom you will have to deal with today. In fact, the crisis today in Kashmir is crisis of leadership.
But Mr. Iyer, India's approach towards Pakistan, basically Kashmir is the fulcrum of it. They want the Kashmir dispute to be resolved. Do you think that the country, especially under the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, will ever get its foreign policy right towards Pakistan? Of course, Prime Minister Modi had in the past pulled a rabbit out of the hat by dropping in at Lahore and going and meeting Mr. Nawaz Sharif. But measures like these, do you feel that in the larger context, these are just eyewash measures and not very serious initiatives are being taken?
Yeah, I think the Pakistan policy has, in my view, as someone who lived in Pakistan as the first Consul General for 3 years, and in the last 35 years, I've been back to Pakistan 35 times.
Right.
And I've been accused of being a Pakistan agent. I have been saying that you must talk to those people because there's a huge constituency for peace in Pakistan. And the more we engage with Pakistan, the more those people are able to validate their position. The more we break it, the more the military, the intelligence comes to dominate policy making. And to some extent, the proof is that every time we talk to the Kashmiris and to the Pakistanis, tension within the valley and from outside, from Pakistan, decreases.
But what is the biggest hindrance for the present government? Why this kind of an engagement, Mr. Iyer is talking about, this kind of an engagement is not happening at all levels? This sort of engagement is missing.
You know, engagement not happening is not the correct statement. And what even Rajnath ji, as a home minister, he had gone and he has asked the people and he met the people, and even before there has been an engagement. With Pakistan, I would like to say, you have to understand, Pakistan is a difficult state. There is no stability. There is no, you know, a kind of defined establishment with which we can talk and whom we can take as a accountable quarter. So the situation we have to understand, and with that situation we have to go forward. So that is what happening, and Modi ji has always taken the risk of taking initiatives with Pakistan. On the first day of the swearing in ceremony,
say something.
Mr. Bajpai demonstrated huge understanding. He didn't have the concept of Pakistan that Mr. Rao has just now placed before us. He was the one who reopened our mission in Karachi and sent me, of all people, as the first person to be the Consul General there. It was he who repeatedly engaged with Pervez Musharraf, despite the butcher of Kargil having become the dictator. He was the one who, despite the failure of the Agra summit, went to Islamabad and worked out the terms on which it could be done. He was the one who went to Kashmir and used those three words, Kashmiriyat, Insaniyat and Jamhuriyat, to be able to open the doors towards the dialogue. So the Modi view, or the Modi government's view of Kashmir, is contradictory not only to the Congress view or the NC view, it's also contradictory to their own view. And that is why I think there is huge immaturity in foreign policy. It's being made Modi-centric. All initiatives are attributed to one human being. All credit has to be given to one human being. And nobody else counts. There has never been a more irrelevant foreign minister than poor Sushma Swaraj. She's an extremely able minister.
Are we missing that kind of a statesmanship, which probably during Vajpayee's regime, which we saw? Do you really feel that the larger bit is that those kind of statesmen are now missing?
You know, I think it goes far beyond that. Statesmen are missing. So what do we do? Suppose they are. I mean, we've got to get on with life, you know. You don't need only a prime minister. I mean, Manish Shankaraiah is good enough to go and talk to the Kashmiris and the Pakistanis. You know, we've got lots of people. You had interlocutors who were sent to Kashmir. Why can't this government use them again today? They're not party people. They were three independent intellectuals, journalists, etc. And there are so many people. I mean, I don't think the crisis is of, statesmen have gone or whatever. I think if the government, at whatever level, with the prompting of the RSS or whatever, you know, we have expert advisors to the government, you know, in case the government fails somewhere. So somebody should be telling the government to take the right initiatives.
Here I would like to say, Manish Shankarji is not fair. At least, you know, when Atalji was Prime Minister, I have never seen that the Congress leaders are, when he was approaching and handling or addressing the Kashmiri problem, he was appreciated like this, as a statesman, as a matured person. So, politics, the bipartisan politics are coming in the way. And Modi ji is also, he has not deviated from what Atalji has said.
I'm coming to the larger question, Mr. Muralidhar Rao, what Mridula ji made a point. That was a very valid point. Why people see BJP playing a double narrative? RSS says something else and BJP says something else. There is a double narrative which is being played out by the present government. Why is this so?
In the context of Kashmir, I don't see there is any
conflict.
One side you are saying that Narendra Modi ji is too powerful and the government is completely centric around him and nobody is important. And then how come that RSS has become more important than Narendra Modi? And how come it has become RSS is able to create an agenda which is away from
Why
Narendra
are people
Modi
saying
and which
that
is
fringe?
Not in agreement? So, you know, we have to be at least...
Why are people saying that fringe has suddenly become the center?
You know, when somebody says fringe, they also mean that somebody says fringe has become center, you know, from 2 it has become 282 is the meaning. You have to understand. So, in a political democracy, 2 can always become 282.
So,
fringe becoming center and center becoming fringe is also, you know, we have to understand what does it...
Okay, so this is the bottom line, that BJP has come back to power with a thumping majority, and now we will throw the floor open to the audience. I'll come to you. Just raise your hands and give them the mic. Yes,
except
go ahead.
One thing.
Yes.
There's more thumping than majority.
More thumping than majority. Okay. Mr. Murli, there are, you'll have to answer for that, but we'll go to the audience now. Yes, go ahead. Your question to whom?
I'd like to pose my question to Mr. Manishankar, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you stated in your comments that the foreign policy of India is in a state of disarray. But then to look on the flip side of the coin, the same foreign policy is going to bring many investors into the country. The GST bill, which has been recently passed with the combined efforts of both Congress and the BJP, will look to increase the growth rate of our country to around 8%, quoted by our RBI Governor, Mr. Rajnath Singh. So I'd like to ask you for your views on this.
The Westinghouse deal, which is a great example of the foreign investment that's going to be brought into this country, will require an expenditure by India of $190 billion. Is this the kind of foreign investment we want? Foreign investment in India has been increasing ever since the government of India, the Congress government of India, decided that they should be inviting foreign investment. That happened in 1991. It's been steadily increasing. There's some addition now, good, but please don't attribute this increase in foreign investment to just the arrival of the Modi government or anything that they may have said. We were talking about foreign policy.
Right.
We come to economic policy. In foreign policy, the disarray is found in tom-tomming everywhere that we are going to get into the NSG. And then what happened? There's even a last-minute meeting with the Chinese. This is not the way you run foreign policy. Equally on Pakistan. Make it personal. You don't make it institutional. With Nepal. It's a friendly neighbor.
Muralidhar Rao, you admit to the fact that there have been mistakes while dealing with China, with countries like Nepal, with Pakistan. There has been some kind of a mistake.
I want to understand first. There is a person coming from a party which has ruled this country for 50 years. And reviewing the success and failures of the foreign policy, it is possible. I can understand. But a government which has come into power for last just 2 years, and now you started talking about the failures. This is, you know, one cannot understand. How can you judge within 2 years,
okay,
that the failure of
this will be never ending.
Second, here I would like to another explanation. Here,
institutionalization.
Jawaharlal Nehru, as a leader, as a prime minister, and as a popular person, he also influenced and steered the foreign policy.
Okay, we'll take the next question.
Narendra Modi ji, yes, as a prime minister, doing college? Something.
Sir, on one angle, you are saying there is space in your government to the other democratic parties. And on the other hand, in the Rajasthan State Board, you are just omitting the name of first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. And after that, you are omitting also the name of who killed to the Mahatma Gandhi. And the other hand, when our Prime Minister is saying now to the Gorakshakas that you should, he addressed, तुम्हें पॉलिथीन खाने से गायों को बचाना चाहिए तो उससे भी काफ़ी सेवा हो जाएगी. Why didn't this statement come out after the Dadri lynching? Why is there a fear that after the Dalits will go out of Hindu policy?
Okay, or let him give the answer now.
Keeping or incorporating somebody's name in the history book and excluding somebody's name from the history book, if that is the criteria, then Congress or other political parties cannot go away from this. You know, just taking one example from somewhere and you are generalizing, that is the danger to democracy and danger to the parliamentary democracy, and there is no space for the opposition. You know, corrections have been made many times, even for BJP, and Prime Minister also had issued statement on many times. Even the party leaders who have given wrong statement or taken wrong steps, they have been admonished and they have been expelled, many such incidents. So BJP's commitment for the democracy, I don't think even adversary can doubt. If
so
that is the situation,
the BJP,
then
is BJP more nationalistic than Congress? Is that what
you're
hinting at?
You know, it is not a good state.
to discuss about Congress is less nationalistic and BJP is more nationalistic, and nationalism is the issue
on which we should judge.
There may be certain issues on which we differ.
Okay.
It is not that they are less patriotic and BJP people are more patriotic. This is not the correct way of looking at the things.
Can I ask him a question?
Yes, yes, Mr.
In that case, what do you mean by Congress Mukt Bharat?
Congress Mukt Bharat
BJP
is the context.
Congress Mukt Bharat is the end goal of BJP.
You know, Congress Mukt Bharat in a context of elections.
Okay.
You know, in a context of a regime we had, in a regime we had, we wanted Congress Mukt Bharat. In emergency also, you know, we wanted Congress Mukt Bharat.
I'll come to you. Okay. Yes, go ahead with your question.
My question is to Mr. Rao. Sir, actually, sir, अभी चाइना से जो स्टील वहाँ पे मैन्युफैक्चर हो रहा है और इंडिया में जो स्टील मैन्युफैक्चर हो रहा है, तो सर चाइनीज़ मार्केट हमारे इंडिजीनियस मैन्युफैक्चरर्स को काफ़ी इफेक्ट कर रहा है और हम लोग कम्पीट नहीं कर पा रहे उनसे. एक जगह हम मेक इन इंडिया की बात कर रहे हैं सर, उससे हम फॉरेन इन्वेस्टर्स को बुला रहे हैं, बट हम जो अपने मैन्युफैक्चरर्स हैं, इंडिया के मैन्युफैक्चरर्स हैं, इंडिजीनियस मैन्युफैक्चरर्स को किस तरीके से हम एम्पावर कर रहे हैं, उस पर हमारा कितना फोकस है उनको एम्पावर करने पर. एंड मैम, एक मेरा क्वेश्चन इसी से रिलेटेड है सर. ग्लोबलाइजेशन है, इंटरनेट का पावर है, सोशल मीडिया है, बट सर जब स्टार्टअप करने की बात आती है, जब लाइसेंसेस लेने की बात आती है, तो सर वन विंडो प्रोसेस क्यों नहीं है इंडिया में, जैसे काफी यूरोपियन कंट्रीज में वन विंडो.
इनफैक्ट हिज ओन क्वेश्चन, आई मीन
चीन के साथ जो हम स्टील आयात कर रहे हैं यहाँ पर, ऐसी जो समस्याएं हैं जो ट्रेड के संदर्भ में, और ट्रेड में दो बातें अलग अलग हैं. एक कि हमारे जो इंटरनल कैपेसिटी और कुल मिलाकर के जो डोमेस्टिक इंडस्ट्री को कैसे प्रोटेक्ट करना और कैसे सेफ गार्ड करना, इस विषय में हम समय समय पर इस विषय में सरकार, कोई भी सरकार है, इस विषय में काम करती है, वो करना चाहिए, और इसमें कुछ कमी है तो उसको भी ठीक करना. लेकिन इसमें और एक फ्रेमवर्क है, WTO. तो WTO संदर्भ में भी हम मान लीजिए कभी अपने पास कुछ सेफ गार्ड्स होते हुए भी कई बार हम डिस्प्यूट सेटलमेंट में जाना पड़ता है. फिर अभी पोल्ट्री इंडस्ट्री में हम हार गए थे कि अमेरिका के साथ. तो इस विषय में भारत अपने घरेलू उद्योग को विश्व की प्रतिस्पर्धा में लाने के लिए जो भी हमने कुछ काम किया है, उसमें करते हुए भी अपने घरेलू उद्योग को बचाना, और मेक इन इंडिया का अर्थ घरेलू उद्योग को नहीं बचाना और कोई केवल फॉरेन इन्वेस्टमेंट को लाना, ये संभव नहीं है. और भारतीय जनता पार्टी का मानना हमेशा है कि फॉरेन इन्वेस्टमेंट और फॉरेन प्ले विल बी ओनली अ सप्लीमेंट्री थिंग. द मेन कंट्रीब्यूशन विल ऑलवेज कम फ्रॉम द डोमेस्टिक इंडस्ट्री, डोमेस्टिक सेविंग्स एंड डोमेस्टिक
इन्वेस्टमेंट. डू यू रियली अग्री विद व्हाट मिस्टर राव इज सेइंग? एंड यू नो, कैंपेन्स लाइक मेक इन इंडिया, डिजिटल इंडिया, स्किल इंडिया, the analysts say that these are just political rhetorics and not on the ground reality is something different totally.
I'm afraid that so. If you look at the figures, even this morning I was reading that last month there was a little pickup in exports and it's gone down again. So exports have been declining now for more than 18 months consistently. Imports are declining as well. When you have a booming economy and you're talking about 7.5% rate of growth, that's not generally the story that you see, because this is a globalized world and one of the indications of growth is that you're getting more and more integrated with the world. Let me put in one more fact. Again, what is happening, if you look at job creation, which affects particularly young people who are coming out of courses like these young people in this group today, this is a jobless growth that we are seeing. I don't have the figures with me right now, but it's abysmal. The job creation that we are seeing right now is abysmal. So again, there are very, very serious, and I'm not even talking about the growing inequality. I'm not even talking about the section of the population, more than one third, that remains below the poverty lines. There's no solid effort to reduce inequality. In fact, Narendra Modi, of course, he's corrected himself now, but he started out by saying he wants to keep MNREGA as a monument to the folly of the Congress. He wants to preserve it like an archival or an archaeological relic. He realized later that the poor of this country are surviving because of MNREGA, and the Congress had the wisdom to put in something which is the minimal social security that they have. It's not the reality of this government
at all. The World Bank data figures,
what the US wants is happening here today.
But the World Bank data figures also show that the economic growth which we are talking about between 2009 to 2014, it was almost 8%, but it has dropped now by 7.5%. So there is a difference by 0.5%. What is the reason for this decline?
In this program, I thought 70 years of freedom as a nation, what we have achieved, economically what we have achieved, and socially what we have achieved, and politically also what we have achieved. Otherwise, this kind of discussions we will be every day doing, and government criticism of government and this government and that government, state government. This is an everyday affair.
But this point emanated only from the audience, sir.
Now I am coming to the important point. You know, foreign investment. Foreign investment, when we talk about, particularly in the defense sector, if you see, importing the defense, ammunition. As a big country and with a lot of security issues and concerns, if we start importing, then we can understand what will be the impact on the global market.
Okay.
So, as a country, when we are aspiring to become a global power or member of the Global Administrative Council, so definitely we have to achieve some kind of self-reliance. So, in that context, instead of importing completely from the foreign countries, it's better even if they come here and they join with other domestic players and create a domestic muscle that will ultimately help in the long run.
Okay, so from what Mr. Rao has said, the intent is right. The roadmap has been laid out. So now another 2.5 years for BJP to go. We'll see how they implement the policies, how they carry on and execute Make in India, Skill India. That time will say. Okay, next question.
And my question is to Muralidhar, sir. So you just said about 1975, that is condemnable. Okay, correct. But from what you just said, from 2 to 280, after you came into power, what the BJP did, I'm talking about Uttarakhand and Arunachal Pradesh. I want to quote what the High Court said in the terms of Uttarakhand. The BJP is cutting down at the roots of democracy. And apart from that, last month what happened, first time ever Supreme Court restored government, removed the government which was in power.
Okay.
And restored Congress. So
yes.
Is that the dual track or the double standard with the BJP is maintaining?
Let him answer now. Yes.
Good question you have asked. This is not the first time a central government has approached this problem, and the first time BJP is only
targeted. Goods
and now I want to say, this is in Arunachal, don't throw the problem of Congress on BJP. The problem has come from Congress. And the problem is within, and it is internal problem.
Mr. Iyer, democratic institutions getting threatened? What do you have to say?
Of course they're threatened. In Arunachal, the speaker had fixed a date on which the vote of confidence would take place. At that point, we would determine whether the Congress had the majority or not. Now, to prevent that from taking place after due consideration, the governor intervenes. The governor intervenes, not only forces who should be presiding over the session, but when it should take place and where it should take place and what should be the agenda. This kind of interference we've never seen
Mr.
before.
Mr. Rao, all this is and happening when the country enters
And that is why the Supreme Court has condemned the BJP and its actions in such unmistakable
term. A quick comment from Mr. Rao before we go on to the next person.
The very straight question I have answered, but I am very surprised to listen from my friend, senior leader from Manishankar Iyer, that Congress has never done it. I come from Andhra Pradesh. I come from Telangana. What happened with N.T. Ramarao? What is the history of
BJP, when it comes to bad things, it's the Congress BT.
Let's take the next question because we have to wind up the show.
My question is that in the long run, what is the solution? Because nobody accepts the failure. Even today we have seen that nobody accepts. Even if Congress is in the power or beat BJP, they always play the blame game. So what is the solution for democracy to build up?
I think the solution for a healthy, vibrant democracy is that young people like you should come forward and take part in politics in a big way.
So what's your lesson? You
take responsibility.
Okay. Mr. Iyer, quick word from you. What is really the road ahead? Despite of all what we have discussed in the last 1 hour, all the problems, what is really the road ahead for making India into a vibrant democracy?
The road ahead is to first recognize the enormous progress that we have made,
okay,
as a country, I'm not giving the credit only to the Congress.
Okay.
Please note that we have gone from a growth rate of 0.72% on an average in the 50 years before independence, first under Jawaharlal Nehru, 3.5%, then it went up to 6%, then it's gone up to 8%. Okay. So therefore, if we can grow despite all our difficulties, I think the future indicates that we are going to become a more and more important economic power, provided we look to the poor and see to it that they too participate in the growth process. But if you become arrogant and say, we are now going to be in, what did he call it? The Global Administrative Council, that we are a power,
okay,
that really
I'm
matters.
I'm really running out of time.
Then all kinds of stupid and silly things are done. I would suggest that we be modestly proud of our past and confident in our future. And that's the way forward.
Okay, Mr. Rao, quick comment from
somebody's
you.
Somebody's confidence becomes some arrogance for somebody.
Okay.
You know, we have to understand.
Does that the sum up the road ahead?
You know.
Does that sum up the road ahead, you know, for the Indian democracy?
You know, this country is a country of 125 crore. And we have achieved a lot of, you know, green revolution, food security, and political democracy we have achieved.
So you will.
And we have reduced the poverty. There may be some shortcomings. There may be. And we have been able to create an inclusive democracy. All these things. So
which means you will build up. You will build up on the Nehruvian legacy. All what have been, what has been done over the last 69 years.
Time to time, different leaders have created impact, and in future also some other people will definitely create impact. As a nation, as a and one people, we will be able to achieve, and we have a lot of potential.
So that's a positive note, Mr. Rao, to end the program. But all we can say is that we have to learn from the past and build on the future to make India into a vibrant democracy. And as India enters into the seventh decade of freedom, it's time for all of us to celebrate, for the entire nation to celebrate, not getting into any kind of blame game as to what Congress has done, what BJP has done. But it's time again to celebrate. Thank you, all of you, this vibrant set of audience and panelists, to come here and enhance the program in a big way. Thank you all. Swadesh hai tera, tujhe hai.